Hello and welcome to Film Company in South. Today we're going to be doing an Ask BR on Petta, the Rajinikanth film directed by Karthik Subbaraj. Jinesh Murli asks, BR, if you were Rajinikanth, would you do another movie with Subbaraj and that too his kind of movie? So I'm going to read another question which kind of goes along the same lines. Manikantan asks, for Kala, people said it was more of a Ranjit film than a Rajinikanth film, and for Petta, they're saying it's more of a Rajini film than a Karthik Subbaraj film. How do you see this? If that's the case, then what do they actually expect from Rajinikanth? The reason I'm reading, combining both these questions is that I think I would definitely do another movie with Karthik Subbaraj because of all his recent films. I think this is the closest that's come to capturing the gesturality that Rajini stands for. What he is as an actor, what he is in terms of star charisma, what he is in terms of, you know, just occupying the screen. I think no other recent film has done it to the extent that this has, you know, because if you look at 2.0, it's full of, you know, Rajini's kind of buried under all the visual effects and things like that. Whereas this, it's actually built around Rajinikanth. The whole thing goes around with him, and nobody serviced his image to this extent in a long, long time. So yes, so if I were Rajinikanth, I would definitely do another movie with Subbaraj. But this is where I get to the second question, which is, for Petta, they're saying it's more of a Rajini film than a Karthik Subbaraj film. That's what people seem to be saying. But I would disagree, because I would say this starts off as a complete out-and-out Rajinikanth film, right? It's celebrating him. It's celebrating all his mass moments, his signatures. But in the second half, it slowly moves to be a Karthik Subbaraj film. So I don't think this is a completely a Rajinikanth film. I don't think it's completely a Karthik Subbaraj film either. Let me explain with just one of the many instances, which is the moral universe of a film. Now, a film builds its own moral universe. So you start off with Rajinikanth's moral universe, which is typically that he is a very moral person, right? So he is coming when there are bad things happening. Like there's ragging happening, he prevents that, right? When there's, there's lovers are being targeted and things like that, he comes and stops that. So that is all very much part of the Rajinikanth universe, because he is helping good prevail, right? In the second half though, we see a very different kind of Rajinikanth, because one of my favorite scenes of this movie is when that murder happens at the funeral, and the Rajinikanth you see there is not the Rajinikanth from the first half, the Rajinikanth from the Rajinikanth universe. It's a Rajinikanth put into the Karthik Subbaraj universe, which is full of black comedy and a very twisted kind of moral universe and a very Tarantino-esque kind of situation. So now you have people smacking their lips in glee when they have to commit murders and things like that. And that is not this universe at all. So that's why I'm thinking one of the many things that this movie is it's half a Rajinikanth movie and it's half a Karthik Subbaraj movie. It is not completely. You may enjoy the fact that Rajinikanth is, you know, there throughout the movie. I'm not denying all that. But in terms of the world building and things like that, this is definitely a movie that exists pre-interval and post-interval, and each of those halves is a very different film. Thy View says, how do you review a film? I mean, you had some expectations from Karthik Subbaraj and you hope it'll be something on those terms, but every film sets its tone in the first 10 minutes. In that case, KS succeeded in showing Rajini the way fans wanted to see him from last 10 years. Again, I go back to what I just said. The first 10 minutes lead me to believe that this is going to be a Rajinikanth movie, a traditional Rajinikanth movie, and that happens for almost an hour. But then the movie completely becomes a different movie. It moves into a different zone. And I think that's why my particular review came about and said the things that it did. Not because, not because I had expectations from Karthik Subbaraj, or not because I wanted a Karthik Subbaraj movie entirely, but because a Rajinikanth movie suddenly transformed into a Karthik Subbaraj movie and it became all kinds of things. I mean, even the way the ending happens. I mean, I assume you guys have seen this movie. If you haven't, please stop watching, because Ask BR is for those who have seen the movie. But even the way the ending happens, Rajini killing with, you know, that kind of Chanakyan statesmanship and all that, Suchi and things like that, that never happens. He's a very straightforward guy. In all the movies that Rajini's been a gangster or a killer or something, he's always had very strong moral reasons and very easy ways of doing this. He's never really, you know, used the Sriram and Vali kind of strategy that happened. That's never happened. So, you know, again, I would say that is all coming, all that goes against the first 10 minutes of the movie. And actually, I enjoyed, as much as I enjoyed the Rajini signature in the first half, I actually started enjoying the movie more when it became a Karthik Subbaraj movie, simply because now I was seeing both a Rajini movie and a Karthik Subbaraj movie. So it kind of worked for me and in that way. Vishnu Ram says, during the climax, Vijay Sethupathi slapped Nawaz by saying he killed his mother, but he has a chance to prove that Vijay is his son, but director wanted to keep it as a twist. This looks like a blunder thing. Yeah, actually that didn't work for me at all. I mean, I like that twist with the end twist where, you know, where that Wali and Rama story is told. But this particular thing, all that Nawazuddin has to say, for some reason, he doesn't seem interested in convincing Vijay Sethupathi that, dude, I am your father. That doesn't seem to happen, because had he done that, then the screenplay would have been violated. So I think that is, you know, something that I was not very happy about the way it was written. I think it should have been better written. Vimal Lakshman asks, in your review, you mentioned the half-hearted subplots. Don't they work well as obvious red herrings? Similar to Basha, we have petty villains obstructing Rajini's duty. Doesn't it serve, though generic, serve its double purpose? You know, the reason I understand that, the reason I didn't like want those too many subplots, especially the Bobby Simha subplot, is because I felt that that really prevented the Rajini Simran angle from being explored. I would have definitely liked some kind of a love angle to have been there, you know, because she's there for a ridiculously short time. And when you cast a major star like Simran, you kind of want her to be used in a slightly better way. That's why I think I had a problem with it. Apart from the fact that they didn't lead to much, you know, the Bobby Simha especially, you know, he starts off as the head terror boy, and you know, you think he's going to lead into something, he's going to become something interesting and important, but then he ends up holding an umbrella for Rajinikanth, which may be part of the larger point that Karthik Subbaraj is making, that you know, everyone ends up being a satellite of Rajinikanth or whatever. But you know, that's too much of a build-up for such a minor character, and he just disappears after that. He doesn't come across in the second half at all. So you know, all these things made me kind of not respond very well to these smaller subplots. Gautam Bhaskar Surapinni says, do you think the lighting and the colors toward the climax played an important role in making the film more interesting? I felt that without the colors, the gangster element would have been bland. I don't think it's just the colors alone. Yes, it reinforces a strong, you know, subconscious way we respond to a film, because colors are very strong. You know, they motivate emotions in very understated and strong ways. But I think the gangster element has been showcased more by the writing and by the fact that Karthik Subbaraj has written certain things a certain way than just the lighting alone, you know. So I don't think that's the reason at all. Jay says, what do you think of the Kali Petta character? I thought there was something about this character that seemed to distinguish itself from other Rajini characters. Genuine Kettavan vibe to it. Definitely, there is a genuine Kettavan vibe to it, which is why I wished the whole film had this genuine Kettavan vibe to it. Or it had been the other kind of Rajini movie, where the whole movie had been a celebration of the 90s kind of Rajinikanth. This kind of halfway thing was a little unsatisfying for me. Also, would love to hear your thoughts on the meta self-aware nature of scenes. I thought they really worked, some of them. But let's also understand the word meta for a minute. You know, just because something is referencing something, it doesn't become meta, because there has to be a subtextual layer in addition to a narrative layer where you're getting into meta. Whereas here, the layer itself, the top layer itself, is the fact that it's an homage to Rajini. So that is the main layer. You know, in the first half, we are talking about a film that is not at all hiding the fact that it is a celebration of Rajinikanth, the brand, over the years. So I don't know how much of it can be truly called meta. For instance, you know, if you're talking about the fact that the Basha plot point is referenced, or the fact that the lighting looks like Talapathy, I don't know if that's meta as much as an explicit homage to what's happening. Rajiv says, Tamil cinema is obsessed with Hindi-speaking villains. Even Petta had Tamil guy settling UP and ruling the north. Why is Bombay or UP backdrop needed? We get offended when Tamils are stereotyped in Bolly films, but what are we doing to them? I think the reason is we get offended is slightly different, because they are shown in a typical South Indian accent, and you know, wearing this vibhuti patta and things like that, and they look like caricatured South Indians. Whereas if you look at Nawazuddin Siddiqui or Vijay Sethupathi here, they look right, you know, they don't look wrong. They look like proper North Indians and stuff like that. So the offense is not there. But where I would say the thing is, the Hindi speaking, I don't know why that even happened, because you're talking about, you know, I read a very interesting analysis that the reason they wanted it set in UP is to show that Rajinikanth is not going to be part of the BJP, because he is going to this place, this ruled by this Hindutva gang, and destroying them. So he's kind of, that is to show that Rajnikanth is not going to align himself with the BJP. Be that as it may, I'm only talking about the movie. And I don't think that this was, I really don't know why we're obsessed with Hindi speaking villains. But I think sometimes what happens is, it lends some flavor, like you've explored, the Madurai villain is done to death. The rich villain is done to death. So I think this is just like the current flavor that happens where you have this, there has to be something that distinguishes the villain from the hero. So if the hero is poor, the villain has to be rich, that kind of stuff. So I think this is one of the ways you can set a polarity differently and still make it somewhat interesting. Ragini says, I feel the Kamal fan in you, knowing or unknowingly, makes you hate Rajni. Need an answer if you could. If you read my review, you will know that this is not a hate Rajni kind of review at all. And if you've read my review of Dasavataram and Uttama Villain and all these things, you will know that my liking for Kamal has not come in the way of my disliking those films. So I don't know how to answer this question except to point you to those reviews and say, actually read those reviews and then make up your mind. Sivaram says, I see you like the climax twist. Yes, I did. But I felt I was cheated because we have a scene that suggests otherwise. Singaram looking at a kid which seems alive at the blast scene, kept only to mislead, as it sees no other purpose. A good twist should be doing that right. I like the twist in the way it unfolded because there was a genuine, I did not expect it coming. For me, a twist is more like that. Did you expect it coming or did you not see it coming? And I didn't see this coming. And it also gelled well with the Karthik Subbaraj universe part of this film, because you're talking about somebody doing a very devious thing, and you look at Jigadanda, the devious thing that Siddharth does to make a movie with that he wants to do versus making a movie that Asal Sethu thinks he's going to make. In a way, this is also split like that, right? Because you're talking about a movie that Rajnikanth expect and the movie that has Karthik Subbaraj's signature, both of them come in. So yeah, that's why this climax twist worked for me. Ash49 says, don't you think your assessment of Petta was harsh given the fact that you review a movie based on what it set out to do? Petta was an out and out Rajini film, which is how it was marketed to. It was not an out and out Rajini film, and I've explained that. Prasad Sarangapadi says, I could see a lot of Easter eggs in the movie, references to all these films like Mullu Malarum, Gangs of Vasipur, etc., etc. Is this a way of telling us that you can never separate the fan from the star? I think the Easter eggs are more like fun things that you kind of, they were not, if you notice, none of these Easter eggs are buried really deep. They're all pretty much on the surface. So we are meant to kind of immediately look at these and smile. The reference to Mullu Malarum or whatever it is, the name Kali, all the lighting and things like that. So yes, you can't separate the fan from the star. I don't know, because there have been other Rajni films. Rajni films have always been self-aware at some level. I mean, a lot of the big star Rajni films, the big star value Rajni films, because he's always kind of winking at his image, winking at the audience, and kind of that's the performance. It's like a Mullu Malarum or a Talapathi kind of movie, Arilirunda Arubadavare. Those kinds of movies are relatively rare in the latter part of his career. Most of them play on the fact that Rajni is such a big brand, Rajni is such a big star. So I think this is along those lines. Again, from Prasad Sarangapani says, I can see Karthik Subbaraj clearly spelling out the different tones for the first and second part of the film. Do you think current directors are facing a struggle to find the right balance between Rajni's masterness and their own creative impulses? I don't think this particular film is a struggle because I felt that Karthik Subbaraj deliberately wanted the first half to be a Rajnikanth homage, like this, the fan, in him talking. So the first half was the fan directing the movie, and the second half was Karthik Subbaraj directing the movie, which is why in the first half, Karthik Subbaraj goes behind Rajnikanth and follows the Rajnikanth path. We talked about the moral universes earlier and things like that. Whereas in the second half of the movie, Rajnikanth follows Karthik Subbaraj's path and does the things that you expect a Karthik Subbaraj character to do. I don't know if it's the right balance because it didn't quite work for me. The halves didn't exactly gel for me. But yeah, this is probably one way to do, to do both, to get both things. Because you do the movie that you want to make in one half, and the other movie is the other movie that you want to make. Roshash says, are you able to separate the Rajni, the star, and the politician while watching the movie? Won't it cloud the view of the character? No, I wasn't even thinking of Rajni the politician until I came to that comment later on, which said, like I said, that BJP thing. I wasn't even thinking of Rajni the politician. Shreya Srinivasan says, your thought on similarities between Kala and Petta, both address the issue of land and power, the former being more of a director's film and the latter more of the star's film. I think Petta's a far more successful film than Kala in terms of what it sets out to do, because it's on a lighter way. See, the problem with Kala and Kabali is that they're films that you really admire because they try to say something ideological with the help of a big star. But Rajni is, in my opinion, too big a star to kind of mold into that kind of a, you know, universe. I feel it fits much better in a twisted Karthik Subbaraj kind of fun black humor, twisted kind of universe. And I wish the whole film had been that kind of movie where we'd seen Rajinikanth from start to finish in that bad, like, you know, you almost want that line, Ketta Payana Sir in the Kali. You almost want that line because you want him to be really a Ketta Payana throughout the movie, you know. Sujit Venkatesh says, has Karthik Subbaraj deviated a lot from his style of filmmaking to more of a Rajini film? We talked about this. What do you think could have been done differently to satisfy both his fans and Thalaivar fans? I think what could have been done differently, simply that the whole movie could have been both Karthik Subbaraj and Rajini movie instead of it being half a Rajinikanth homage and half a Karthik Subbaraj movie. That's what I would have felt. Arun Yuvaraja says, watching a review, felt you were let down by the actor-director combo, whereas the fans who were enjoying the movie had expectation from the actor alone. Correct me, shouldn't the reviewer review a movie as a separate entity and not compare it with the earlier successors of the actor-director? I'm not comparing this movie with the earlier Karthik Subbaraj movies at all. Like I said, I'm only comparing it with what this movie is trying to do. That is, if it had been a full Rajinikanth movie or a full Karthik Subbaraj movie, that would have been something that I would have liked. Not because it's like half and half. That's my whole problem with it. Arun Yuvaraja says, if KSR had directed the same movie instead of Karthik Subbaraj, would expectations and ratings change? Not at all, because you don't review a movie based on who's starring in it or who's directed it or whatever it is. Is the movie working for you? Yes, the who's starring or who's directing certainly sets a certain expectation level. But once 10-15 minutes are over, the movie tells you what to expect and what it's going to do. So you really base your review on that rather than who the people are behind the movie. Anantan says, what is the connection of Petta with religion, particularly the revenge and Mahashivaratri thing? There is a lot of religious thing. If you notice the first half, there's a lot of Christian imagery and Christian symbolism, which is you always find in Karthik Subbaraj's films. The second half is getting into this Hindutva zone, lots of, UP and Hindu heartland kind of thing. I haven't really parsed the movie. I need to watch it a second time to kind of remove the plot and see all the other stuff that's happening. So that's definitely one of the things that I'm going to look for when I watch it a second time. And Surya Prakash finally says, should we in Tamil cinema write better characters for the best actors in the country? Petta, Nawazuddin, Samar, Manoj Bajpayee, Sarvam, J.D. Chakravarti, Veeram, and many other films, Atul Kulkarni, NH4, K.K. Menon. Yeah, I was really disappointed in the way Nawazuddin Siddiqui was used in this film because he seemed like the plotting, conniving kind of villain, and Nawazuddin plays that kind of villain. He has played that kind of villain before, but something didn't gel, and I think it's because he was not really used in a very powerful way. Like I said before, you know, when motivations are kind of weird, you kind of start not identifying with the characters as much. For instance, like we discussed before, why doesn't Nawazuddin Siddiqui spend some time and just give Vijay Sethupathi proof that, dude, you are my son? I mean, why doesn't he do that? He's not doing that because if he did that, then Rajini's plan would not be fulfilled according to the screenplay. But that is a bit of cheating because it kind of amps up Rajini's character while, you know, bringing down Nawazuddin's character. It kind of makes him look like an idiot. So I think, you know, those are some of the things that people do. But again, this movie is a celebration of Rajinikanth, and clearly all of you have enjoyed it. So I don't think people are thinking about whether Nawazuddin Siddiqui has been given the better role or not. Yes, it might have been better, but we're really talking about a Rajinikanth movie, and that ultimately is what is making this film work so well at the box office. So that's the end of this episode of Ask BR. We talked about Petta. If you like this video, do subscribe to Film Companion South. See you soon in the next Ask BR.